we have with us Sri Guru Murthy Kashinath sir, and let me introduce him. Guru Murthy Kashinath sir is the founder director of IT for Saints, and he carries around 31 years of experience in development and corporate sector. He leads the organization in research, demonstration project, policy advocacy in the areas of education, systemic teacher education, and school leadership. And sir has designed and conducted evaluation of ICT programs in school and teacher education. And his expertise includes open education resources, ICT integration in education and school leadership. His earlier experience, he worked 11 years in business sector, then 6 years in Government of Karnataka Education Department, 7 years as visiting faculty at the TEACH called Tata Institute of Social Sciences, and 6 years in education technology, education leadership management in Azim Premji Foundation, and 4 years in management consulting, KPMG Management Consulting. And he has foreign experience, other countries experience also. He has experience working with Ghana, Malaysia, Nigeria, Mozambique, South Africa, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Uganda, United Arab Emirates, USA, Zambia, and Zimbabwe. And India, he has worked on many different projects. And he was associated in three very special organizations like Azim Premji Foundation, TEACH called Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai, and Government of Karnataka. He is also has got membership in different committees, all right? Like ACA, he completed his ACA, Institute of Chartered Accountant from India, and he also did his MCom from University of Mumbai. So ladies and gentlemen, I invite you all. I can speak about Murthy Kashinath for hours together, but because of shortage of time, I would like to request all of you to join me to welcome Thiru Guru Murthy Kashinath sir. Sir, welcome, sir. And the stage is there for you now.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Hitesh sir. And you cannot but notice the fact that he referred to me as Thiru Guru Murthy, and that is a tribute to the extraordinary multilinguality of Dr. Hitesh. And I'm sure all of you are aware that although his original state is he's from the Northeast, but as he's working with teachers from South India, he has put in enormous effort to actually understand the languages of all the South Indian states, which is a different language family. We know that there are different language families in India, and South Indian languages form one language family. So it's a different language family for him. Nevertheless, although this is an English teachers institution, his skills in all the languages of South India is much more than mine and much more than possibly many of yours. And I think, thank you very much, Dhanyabad, if I can say, I don't know if that is correct, but I would like to say Dhanyabad to Dr. Hitesh, so that, he continues to, enrich himself and also enrich us. By enriching himself, he's enriching us in multiple languages and in also the literature of multiple languages. So thank you so much, sir. I will start right away with your permission. I'll start right away to explore with the teachers something called Krashen's hypothesis. So I want to start with a simple, thank you, Hitesh sir. Yeah, thank you. I would like to start with a simple poll. You all must be familiar with using, a polling on big blue buttons. So how many of you have heard of Krashen's hypothesis? If you heard of it, say yes. If you're not heard of it, say no. There is this linguist, a person who has worked in language acquisition. His name is Krashen. He is a professor. If you heard of his work, you can say yes. If you're not heard of his work, you can say no. Please press yes or no on your phone or on your computer. This is a election. It's a poll. And in the poll, you have two responses, yes or no. And the question you have to answer is, are you familiar with Krashen's hypothesis? Yes, still many of you have to vote. You're voting, but some of you still have to vote. I will call you by your first names. I hope it's okay by you. Normally, we address one another as sir and madam. I know that. But because of paucity of time and to keep it quick and short, I'll just refer to you by your first names. I'll request people to, teachers who are not talking, to keep themselves on mute, please, so that the disturbance will not be there. Sharji, Ignatius, kindly mute yourself so that it will not disturb the session. If multiple people unmute and keep their mic unmute, then it sort of creates an echo, which is why it disturbs the talk. Of course, type in the chat window. You have to, there is a vote, you have to vote. Hello, am I audible? Harish, can you hear me? Kishore, can you hear me?
Yes sir.
Thank you. Yeah, so request all of you to quickly vote. It's not, don't type in the chat window, but you have to vote now. So Kavipriya,
Nusrat, yes sir, one second.
Yes, sir.
Hello,
yes, sir.
Hello, participants. See on the screen, there is yes and no. You'll have to click there, yes or no. Not don't write in the chat box. There is a polling option. Is there a small screen on the screen that is yes and no? If you don't know, you click on no. If you know, you click on yes. Don't write on the chat box. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Hitesh. So yeah, so this is a poll, and big blue button has a feature for polling, which you can. Yeah. Sikindramma, can you put yourself on mute?
Yeah.
Yeah. So can I publish the results? Sir. Yeah, no problem. It's okay. It should have come. It may be a small button on your screen. It's okay. No problem. So I'll just publish the results. The results say that 72% have not heard of Krashen and 28% have heard of Krashen. So I will assume that mostly people have not heard of Krashen. So I will talk about it from the basics. It's useful to discuss and understand what he said. And sorry, my request to you again, all of you, make sure you're on mute only. Do not keep your mic on unmute, because it will disturb everybody. If you want to talk, then of course you can unmute and talk. But if you're not intending to talk, make sure that your microphone is on the mute mode. Do not unmute, because anytime, even if a single mic is unmute, it will cause a disturbance to the session, which I'm sure is not your intention. So I'm going to start by projecting a mind map. But before that, I want to ask all of you, take two minutes time, and I'm sure you have your pen and paper in front of you. So the question to all of you is, what are the typical challenges you face as an English teacher? What are the typical challenges you face as an English teacher? So just you write it down in your notebook. And after 2 minutes, we will share. You can type in the chat window or you can unmute and talk. Just take the next 2 minutes and write down in your notebook. What are the challenges that you face as an English teacher? What are the challenges an English teacher faces? You can respond to either or both of these questions. What are the challenges that you face as an English language teacher in your classroom with your students in helping them learn English? Or you can broaden it and say, what are the challenges that an English language teacher faces? You may or may not have faced them, but in your opinion, these are some of the challenges that English teachers face. So take 2 minutes time and you can write it down. And then we can share, all of you can share either in the chat window or through the, by unmuting and talking. Kishore, am I clear? If my voice is clear, just type in the chat window that I'm clear. Kavipriya, do you want to talk? Yeah, if you're not talking, make sure your mic is on mute so that it doesn't disturb us. Yeah, thank you, Kishore, for confirming that my voice is clear. If my voice is not clear, Kishore, just let me know. You can unmute and tell me that my voice is not clear so that I can repeat what I said. Sometimes connectivity may not be strong enough and that may lead to voice breaking. It happens once in a while. So I can repeat myself if that happens. Yeah, so we will take one more minute. Think about all the challenges that you have faced as an English language teacher now or in the past, or what you have seen other English teachers face in their process of teaching. Yeah, we can start. You can start typing in the chat window and I will note it down. Whatever you feel are the challenges that English language teaching faces, English language teachers face, please type in the chat window. Already I can see that Fauzia Begum has said students are unable to comprehend the idea that we understand what we are. The children we teach speak English at home. Harish, can you mute your mic, please? None of the children we teach actually speak English at home. Their mother tongue is not English. They are not talking English with their parents or their siblings at home. Most of them will be speaking Telugu or Tamil or Malayalam or, you know, Kannada as the case may be. So that's exactly what Dada Saheb Kamble also says, limited learning environment. Their home environment is not conducive for conversing in English. Inhibition speaking English. Speaking skills are not well developed. Pronunciation of words is a challenge. We all know that English structure is different from Indian language structure. So you might have learnt about it in the CLT program, or you might be familiar about it earlier itself, that English structure is SVO and our Indian language structure is SOV, subject, object, verb. And because of this basic difference in the language structure, many times when we speak English, we speak in the structure that we had our Indian languages, and that creates an error in the English. Vocabulary is a serious issue. Sentence structure, sentence formation is an issue. Second language, we don't have adequate time. You don't get adequate time in the classroom. Multilingual context, children lack motivation. Yeah, so children lack motivation to use language. They are more comfortable speaking in Telugu or Tamil or Kannada in the classroom, and they don't speak or use English. Anand sir, you would like to say something?
Yes sir, good morning sir. Good morning.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, actually I felt the challenges in the classroom by the students sir. Hello? Sir, could you hear me sir?
We can hear you, there is some disturbance at your end, but you go ahead, we can hear you. Go ahead Anand.
Okay sir, first of all my students are unfamiliar with the my language, especially in English, because their mother tongue is Lombardy, sir. And there are some students are irregular absentees, sir. If I taught first day or 1 week in first week, and due to the irregular absent, they are unable to understand what I have taught in last week, sir. Hello. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you, Anand. You're talking about, hello, we could hear you clearly. You're talking about the fact that they speak Lambani in their home, speak English. And second challenge is they're not regular in the school. In the school, they miss lessons and that affects their learning. Yeah, both points are very clear. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Anybody else wants to say anything? So response in English, not getting assistance at home, Bindumal is saying.
Sir,
anybody else wants to speak? One at a time. One at a time. I think Bhujanga Rao, would you like to speak first? We'll go one by one. Bhujanga Rao, go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Sir, actually, what I face in my classroom, the main problem is the pronunciation, sir. My students are majorly facing a problem in pronunciation of certain words in English. They are good at mother tongue, but I observe many times they are following some patterns, but often they are changing for a particular word. The same pattern does not include there. So this is what I observe in my classroom. And other thing is the mother tongue influence on learning of English language is also a major problem. So this aspect makes an obstacle for them to learn English language in a better way. These two are my observations, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. You are now on.
Thank you. Ramya, go ahead. Ramya, then Devi.
Main thing is they couldn't comprehend what we say, and communication is not possible with easy for them to communicate in English. As far as they could easily transact everything, whatever knowledge they have, they will transact us in their mother tongue. And the
Malayalam.
Main thing I feel is that they have some inhibition to speak, not only that, grammatical error. That is the main thing. They feel ashamed while using English language. They don't know the structure very well. I think in the mother tongue, they are not bothered about structure or anything, and they are very much familiar with mother tongue. And they couldn't speak whatever, they could speak whatever they think in their mother tongue. They can speak whatever they want. But in English, they are using this translation method, translating everything. They, whatever we ask, they translate it into their mother tongue, and then they will comprehend in their mother tongue, and then they will translate it, and then they try to speak. That is the main problem. So that will take time, and so they are speak more friendly to us. So they feel an inhibition. So in order to overcome this, I think better hearing of English should be possible for the students. More listening practice should be given, then only they could comprehend easily, and then more hearing leads them to speak more. Well, that's why mother tongue they are using more, I think so. And this is my view. I think better hearing will help them to speak better.
Thank you, Ramya. Thank you, Ramya. Devi wanted to speak. Go ahead, Devi.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning. Go ahead. Good morning. After you, Rajendra Reddy. Go ahead, Devi.
The rural population of India, which depends on agriculture and limited income, their children to government schools, which where English is not taught as a skill but as a subject. India, there is a belief among almost all classes in both rural and urban transformative. The power of English is not seen, not just a skill but a symbol of better life. Thank you, sir.
Sir, may I, sir?
Sir, it is not audible, sir.
Not audible, sir.
Yeah, sorry. I was on mute. That's why you could not hear me. Just give me a minute, and after I speak, Rajendra Reddy and then Sikandrama can speak. So the important point Devi is making is that unlike other subjects, you know, some subjects there may be some dislike or there may be some aversion. English, there may be fear, but there is no aversion, because parents also know, and maybe to some extent children also are aware, that knowledge of English seems to be a ticket to prosperity. We don't know how true it is and how valid that belief is, but there is a widespread belief. In fact, that is why Andhra Pradesh, one of the states who is a part of our program, Andhra Pradesh has, you know, the government is insisting on converting all the schools to English medium schools. What the government is saying is that parents are very much eager for English. So that is Devi's point. And Ramya made a very interesting point that the challenges of translation can be overcome to some extent by greater listening. In fact, that is what Krashen also says. So we will talk about Krashen as soon as we finish sharing. We'll take 5 more minutes to share and then we'll go ahead. Okay. So Rajendra Reddy and then Sikandrama, and then we will stop. Rajendra Reddy.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning. Go ahead.
Sir, we are facing challenges from three sides, teacher side, children side, and language side. Teacher side, English language speaking in the classroom, most of the teachers hesitate to speak English. That is the from teacher side. Sir, from children side, lack of language exposure is there. From language side, so if you come to mother tongue, whatever we speak, we write as digitally. But in English, whatever we speak, we are not supposed to write as is. That is the three challenges we are facing, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Gopal. Last person, Sikandrama, then we'll go ahead. Sikandrama, yes, go ahead. Yes, Sikandrama, then we will stop and then we'll go ahead. Sorry, we're not having sufficient time for everybody to share. Others can type in the chat window. I'll request M. Sikandrama to speak now. Then we will go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Good morning, sir. Usually the Indian children follow the method of say and write, sir. Listen comes last to them. Before they entered the school, they didn't listen the English. They have no platform to expose their English knowledge, what they have learned in a school. Students came from rural area. They have no previous knowledge about English, sir. These are all the problems we face, sir.
Thank you so much. We will stop now because the time is limited. I'm really sorry. I'm happy that many more of you want to share your thoughts. Many of you have written in the chat window. I request all of you who have not spoken and who have not typed in the chat window, please share your thoughts in the chat window. I will save the chat and we will share it back in the Moodle course page, this chat itself, your contribution, so that we can learn from one another. Many of you are saying similar things. You're saying there's not enough practice at home in English. The sentence structure of English is different from Indian languages. English is not a phonetic language, whereas Indian languages are phonetic. So the way we write and the way we speak is different in English. There are not enough opportunities to speak in the classroom. Teachers may not be speaking in the classroom. So there may not be enough time available for teaching English in the school. So we have highlighted several challenges that are there for English teaching. I have just sort of quickly summarized all of these into three or four points. Yeah, so silent letters, when Ramya says that's a problem, that English is not phonetic. Whereas Kannada or Telugu or Malayalam, these are phonetic languages. The way you write and the way you speak, there is no difference at all. And the child comes with that background. So when the child sees a word where H is supposed to be silent, the child doesn't know that that kind of a thing happens. Okay, so I'm going to show you. We'll now start exploring Krashen. Krashen is a linguist, he's a language expert, and he has come out with a set of ideas which can help us to improve English teaching in our schools. And I'm going to talk about that. Sabrinathan, kindly mute yourself. So I'm going to show you a concept. I made something called a concept map, and I'm going to show that to you. Just give me a second.
You are now unmuted.
நிஜனா சிவா
ஹலோ.
Yes, sir. Guru, sir, you are audible, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Harish. Sorry, I had to, my system was hanging, so I had to restart my system. So I'm just going to show you a concept map, and we will look at the concept map together. Are you able to see a concept map? So this is what is called a concept map. And if you want to, I suppose many of you are seeing it on your phone and some of you may be seeing it on your computer. If the concept map is not visible, just type in the chat window that you are not able to see it. If you're able to see it, you can type yes in the chat. I hope you're all able to see the concept map, which is called Prashant's Hypothesis for SLA. You're able to see it. Yeah, so we will discuss a little bit about what is Krashen's hypothesis. Thank you so much for confirming that you're able to see it. So I'm going to go back to the concept map and I'm going to show you individual components of it. Yeah, so we've discussed some of the challenges activities of teaching English, which is that the students' time for practice is inadequate and there is not enough ability building on communication by children, and on so they don't speak correctly in English, they don't use correct language structures. So these are the challenges that children have, and we have looked at them. Okay, so we will look at what Krashen has to say in terms of how English language teaching can be improved, and he came up with 5 hypotheses. So I hope you are able to see these 5 hypotheses on the screen. Yeah, so he had 5 hypotheses to offer, and these are the 5 hypotheses. Can I request Tilakavati to just read these 5 hypotheses? Tilakavati, can you just read out these 5 hypotheses which you see on the screen? Tilakavati, can you unmute? Yeah. Ratna, okay, go ahead. Ratna, can you read the 5 hypotheses on the screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead. Read it out.
Acquisition learning hypothesis, input hypothesis, affective filter hypothesis, acquisition learning hypothesis, input hypothesis. The screen is not clear, sir.
You are not able to see all the hypotheses. I can
very clear. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I can see only the first 2 hypotheses.
Can I read, sir?
Yeah, go ahead.
Can I read, sir? Affective filter hypothesis,
acquisition learning hypothesis, input hypothesis, affective filter hypothesis, monitor hypothesis, natural order hypothesis.
Yeah, thank you so much. So these are the 5 hypotheses and we will look at them very briefly together, and I will explain these hypotheses to you. It has an impact on the way we will teach English in our classrooms. So the first thing Krashen says is language has 2 ways of learning, and one way is called acquisition. I request all of you to mute your mic so that there is no disturbance. So Krashen says that language is learnt in 2 ways. One process is called acquisition and the other process is called learning. Now, learning is a structured process that we use in the classroom, and you can see the points of learning on the screen here. Just one second. Yeah, I suppose you can see the screen now. So he talks about acquisition and learning as the 2 ways of learning a language, and that is applicable to English as well. And he says that in the case of learning, it is a structured way that we teach the children how to learn the language. So we have specific sessions, we have specific activities. We focus on the rules of language. Rules of language primarily is grammar, how the sentence should be structured, how the subject and predicate should be formed, what is direct voice, what is indirect voice. So when we do teaching and when the processes of learning, it's a very structured process, it's very conscious. So we look at the process of learning, and typically that is how we teach in school. We have a timetable, we have one teacher, we have many learners. And Krashen says that the process of learning fails to build communicative competencies in language. So is the screen visible? Are you able to see all the components of the learning point? So learning is a formal and structured way of teaching language.
No,
so
sir.
We go to the classroom. You're not able to see the screen, Anita?
Sir, I can see only a part of things.
Yeah, part only. You can only see a part because the concept map is very big. I'm just focusing on learning. There is a node called learning. We are looking at learning and all the points inside learning. So I hope that is visible. Harish, is that clear? Yes, learning and the points under learning.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So what Krashen says is that there are two ways of learning any language, and one is the formal structured process, which he calls learning. And in learning, there is a lot of structure. We learn language very consciously. We learn the rules of the language. We pay attention to the structure that we are using. And the objective is to learn the language. But he says that the process of learning fails to build communicative competency. So I would like to point out this last point, that the way we go about teaching English in a structured way in the school, where we focus on grammar, where we focus on practice, where we focus on drill, where we make it a artificial activity of learning the language, which is what he calls learning, is not adequate to building communicative competencies in most cases. So he says that for learning the language, the process of acquisition is better. And he says that acquisition is the process by which the first language is learned by the child. So are you able to see acquisition? I just showed acquisition now. Are you able to see the acquisition and its subpoints?
Sir, it's not clear, sir. Better before you have presented that, the good, sir. But
yes,
it is,
sir,
not clear.
Okay, one second.
It's,
so
it's showing as a colored presentation, sir. But black and white is one good, sir. First one.
It is black and white only. What I'm showing
no,
is only
sir,
black
it's,
and
it's,
white.
It's showing in color, sir.
Hello, Guru.
Is it visible, the concept map?
Yeah, it is visible. I think the side color, the icons, it is showing as a color. Maybe
the icon thing, I will just remove the icon toolbar.
Try to minimize it.
But it's not showing the acquisition thing. I think that's a problem.
No, acquisition is visible, bro.
Okay. So, but the subpoints under acquisition, are they visible now?
No.
It's showing only acquisition, right? It's not showing
the
subpoints.
Even now.
Is it visible now? Subpoints?
Sir, I think the subpoints of
learning is visible. Stop the screen share and start it again.
Yeah, I'll do that. I'll stop the screen share and start it again.
Not visible, sir.
Yeah, sorry. I'm just starting. Now, can you see the acquisition
now
of points?
Now it is.
Yeah, so this is the main. I would say there are five hypotheses that Krashen offers us, but the main hypothesis is that acquisition as a process of learning a language, particularly a second language, is more important, at least in the initial stages, compared to learning a language. And the distinction between acquisition and learning is learning a formal structured process in the classroom where the focus is on the language itself, whereas acquisition is an informal process which is very similar to the way the child learns the first language. So we all know that all your children who come to your classroom, almost all of them, if not all of them, are coming to the classroom familiar and competent in a language that they speak at home, which is what we call the first language. We also use the term mother tongue, but a more technical term is first language. That's the first language that the child has learned. So the first language can be Kannada, it can be Telugu, Malayalam, Tamil, as far as our South Indian states are concerned. Of course, there is Tulu, there is Konkani, there are many other languages also. But broadly, the child comes to the classroom with a knowledge of Tamil, Telugu, and of course, in the case of the Deccan Plateau, you will have children coming with Urdu, you know, Dakkani Urdu also to the classroom. Now, how have they learned this language at home? They have learned this language at home using a process called acquisition. And Krashen says that when we are trying to help the child learn English in the school, if we pay attention to the processes of acquisition rather than the processes of learning, we will have greater initial success in helping the child acquire English. And so the main thing about acquisition is the focus is on meaning making, the focus is on fluency and not on accuracy. There's a lot of talking to the child. So Ramya mentioned that a lot of listening is required for acquiring language, and Krashen is saying the same thing. Krashen says that for acquiring English, the child needs to listen to a lot of English. So if you look at what Krashen is saying, he's saying try to mimic the processes by which the child learned the first language. Every child coming to your classroom at the age of 6 in class 1 is already competent in one language. That child was not taught Kannada, the child was not taught in Malayalam, the child was not made to write grammar and sentence structure in any of the languages that the child learned. How did the child acquire that first language? There is a lot of talking to the child. There are multiple teachers. So at home, everybody is a teacher. The mother speaks to the child in Kannada, the father speaks in Kannada, the neighbors speak in Kannada, the grandparents speak in Kannada, the siblings speak in Kannada. So the child is listening to a lot of Kannada throughout the day. It may be Kannada poems, it may be songs, it may be lullabies, it may be nursery rhymes, it may be normal conversation. So that significant amount of talking to the child is a very important process in the child acquiring the language. There is focus on fluency, not accuracy. So when we speak to the child and the child speaks back in the first language at home, there is no emphasis on correctness. If the child makes a mistake, we don't punish the child. We don't make the child write the word 10 times in the notebook. We don't make the child feel that the child has done something wrong. In fact, when the child makes a mistake, we are all happy. We are overjoyed. We celebrate if the child makes a mistake in pronouncing or the child makes an error in the sentence structure. So the focus is the child should speak. It doesn't matter if it's wrong, because we know that once the child becomes fluent in speaking the language, the correctness of communication will improve over time. But if the child is not confident in speaking the language, and if the focus is on getting it correct and accurate the first time, the child will never acquire the confidence to speak the language. So in our schools, the challenge is that children are not confident to speak English. Children are not confident to transact in English. And that is because the focus has been on accuracy rather than on fluency. So when we talk about grammar, automatically we are bringing the focus onto the correctness of language use. And Krashen says that if you put focus on the process of the structure of the language, things like grammar, then the child is not going to acquire the confidence to acquire the language. The other important features of the acquisition process are no or low expectations. If you see the second last node in the bottom, there is no or low expectation. You are not expecting the child to perform. So the child is 1 year old, the child starts talking, the child will become more familiar with the language one over the second year, third year, fourth year. There is no pressure on the child to perform. We don't tell the child, oh, can you tell me 5 sentences about my neighbor? Or can you write a short essay on? So we don't do things like that. So the child doesn't suffer any pressure of language, producing the language. And no or low expectations is an important part of helping the child build confidence in acquiring language. Also, a very important principle in the acquisition hypothesis, there is a long period of silence, and this is really important to understand. So when the child is entering your classroom, it's possible that you are actually teaching middle school or high school. You're not even a primary, of course, here all of you are primary school teachers, but some of you may be teaching middle school and some of you may be teaching lower primary. Very important aspect of L1 learning is there is a long period of silence. In fact, we know that the child doesn't speak at all for the first year, other than making baby be sound. And even later, many children take quite some time to become communicate regularly in the language that they speak at home. So what Krashen says is, before children can become fluent in producing language, they need to get a long period of silence where there is no expectation that they will produce. Don't put pressure on the child to produce, but give the child a lot of opportunities to listen. And as the child keeps listening, and listening to variety of expressions in the language, listening to many people speaking that language over a period of time when there is no pressure to perform, the child will acquire the language and the child will start communicating back in the language. Now, the most important aspect of Krashen's principle of acquisition is the second note from the top, which is meaning making. So Krashen says that, how did the child acquire language one at home? Nobody taught the child Kannada, but the child was spoken to in Kannada saying, wash your hands before you come and eat, or don't go outside. If you go near that place, you are going to fall. So all the communication with the child was meaningful communication. So the child found purpose in that communication process. So Krashen says that whenever we teach English in the classroom, if we are going to restrict ourselves to, let's say, only the textbook that we may have with us, the textbook can contain content which does not necessarily provide meaning to the child. So we may take a poem and we may discuss some, you know, Jack and Jill. For the child, Jack and Jill has no meaning. Of course, now I know textbooks are much better and we have a lot of focus on local and Indian characters. But even then, many of the stories or many of the articles that we have in our textbooks may not necessarily be very meaningful for the child. So the learning of English becomes an artificial activity where the focus is on learning the language itself and the structure of language. Whereas Krashen says, for the child to acquire a second language, which is English in our case, you allow the child opportunities to interact with you and interact with others, where English is used in a meaningful manner for the purposes of making meaning. So the child, you can encourage to talk with the child about experiences the child had at home, some interesting event that happened in the child's life, some festival that was celebrated at home, you know, their interactions with siblings. All these are very meaningful experiences that the child can communicate in the classroom. So if our English classroom becomes a classroom where, instead of looking at material that is not very contextual to the child's life, we are able to bring in experiences and events and incidents which are by themselves of meaning for the children. You know, you went out and you saw some interesting flora and fauna and you're talking about that in the classroom. Maybe the way a butterfly flew, maybe the way a cat behaved outside, maybe the way trees are flowering and fruiting. If those kind of actual experiences of a child come into the classroom, then language learning becomes a process of meaning making. And Krashen says that meaning making is extremely important for acquiring a second language. And one of the reasons the second language acquisition suffers is we use material that is not very meaningful for the children. So this is the first principle of hypothesis of Krashen, which is the acquisition learning hypothesis. Krashen says we spend too much time on learning English in the classroom and not enough time on the acquisition processes. Acquisition processes are similar to that of L1 acquisition, which is the first language child learns at home. And some of these I have given in the concept as subnotes in the map here. So that is, he says, can we as English teachers in our classroom, whether we are teaching class 2 or class 5 or class 7, whatever be the age of the children, their levels of learning may not necessarily correspond to the physical age, may not necessarily correspond to the grade that they're in the classroom. So the point that Krashen is making is, can we focus on acquisition? Okay. So I want to ask you all if there is any question. So this is the most important hypothesis of Krashen. The other ones sort of support and are complementary to this hypothesis. So there are any questions or any doubts or any comments, I invite you to share. We can take a couple of minutes off to discuss this acquisition hypothesis. It's called the acquisition learning hypothesis, but primarily what Krashen is saying is, let us not focus much about learning of English in our classroom. Let us give more energy and attention to acquisition processes, which are very similar to the way the child has acquired the first language at home, where there is less expectation, where there is listening by the child, where there is not a child to perform, where there is not focus on structure of the language, but the focus is on meaning making, where it's focus on fluency rather than on accuracy. These are some important aspects of introducing language into the classroom and helping the child acquire it. Yeah. So we'll take a minute off. Any questions, any comments, any doubts? You can speak.
Excuse
or you
me,
can.
Sir.
Yes, Kavita, go ahead.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, could you please explain once that subconscious, about subconscious? I didn't get properly that one.
Yeah. I didn't explain subconscious. Let me explain now. So what Krashen says is language learning happens in a subconscious manner. So the formal learning of languages, you say, you know, tell me the spelling of battle. Tell me the spelling of kettle. So there you're consciously trying to help the child learn language by saying, I want you to get the spelling right. But subconscious is, as you're talking to somebody, let's say you're watching a Hindi movie, you're not familiar with Hindi, but you have put your television on and you're watching a Hindi movie. In that, the learning of Hindi is subconscious. Lot of things get into your mind, not at a conscious level, but at a subconscious level. And that is the way child learns the first language at home. It's not entirely a conscious process. As the child is listening and listening and listening, so many things go into the subconscious of the child. So acquisition is not only a conscious, acquisition is a conscious plus subconscious process. Whereas learning is essentially a conscious process. So that is what he means by subconscious. And to invite, to involve the subconscious, immersing the child in listening is very important. So Ramya spoke about listening and we use the word immersion. So the child should be immersed in the language, drown the child in language, drown the child in English, poetry, prose, song, play, skit, all kinds of activities, but which are meaningful for the child, which are not, you know, King of England. If I have something, you know, some of these Wordsworth poems that we have in our school about daffodils, the child may not have seen a daffodil at all in his or her life. And therefore, what Krashen is saying is, can we bring activities and ideas which encourage the child to engage with English in a manner that is meaningful for the child, with where the transactions in the classroom are pertaining to issues, events which are relevant and meaningful for the child's life. Yeah, so that is the point. So that's subconscious. Anything else? Any other comments, any questions, any doubts anybody has got? Is the idea of acquisition clear? Yes,
sir.
Anand, sir, and then Fauzi. Anand, go ahead.
Give me the example of affective filter hypothesis, sir. Example.
We will go to affective filter a little later. We are still on acquisition. We'll go one by one. We'll come to affective filter. Yeah. I have not finished all the hypotheses. We have just done the first one. If there are any questions or comments, you can ask. Fauzia, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Here. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're very audible. Go ahead.
Okay. I think most of the teachers are teaching. Sorry, most of the teachers are treating English as a subject. As a language. This is one of the reasons why our students are usually facing difficulty to speak. If we give them lots of answers to listen, and just like our mother tongue, if we are adding various decisions to them, they will also speak. The thing is, language should be taught as language, not as a subject.
Yes, I think Fauzia is making a very important point. I'll just rephrase what she's saying. She's saying many times we teach language like a subject. What she means by that is, in a subject, let's say you're teaching science, you're teaching a chapter called electricity. There the focus is electricity. But in English, if you're teaching, let's say, Oliver Twist, you're taking a part of Oliver Twist and you're talking about it in the classroom. The purpose is not to make the child an expert on Oliver Twist. Oliver Twist is simply an excuse for you to engage with English in the classroom. So that is Fauzia's point, that English teachers should not get bogged down by the content of the textbook. A science teacher, or a teacher, or a social science teacher has to focus a lot on the content, because if I'm teaching 1857 revolt, I have to focus on 1857 revolt. But the same 1857 revolt is an English textbook, then really the purpose is not that the child should become an expert in understanding 1857 revolt, but can the child express his own or her own ideas about rebellion, about revolting, about fighting, about independence, about foreign rule. So if the child acquires ability to communicate these ideas, then the English teacher's job is done. So Fauzia's point is very important, we should stop teaching English like it is a sub, it is a subject. We should stop focusing on English teaching where the content is important. Instead of the content, the communication skills that the content will help us trigger becomes very important. And Narmada is also making a very important point. Language learning is learning to swim. So you have to practice. You cannot learn swimming by sitting on the side of the pool and somebody tells you the theory of swimming. You have to jump into the water and you keep swimming, 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 swimming. Keep on swimming. Then only you will acquire the ability to swim. In the same way, language is also a skill. So unless we keep practicing language, we will not acquire language. It is not enough to simply theoretically analyze grammar and structure of language. It's very important to practice language. But Narmada, in the practice of language, what Krashen says is, the practice, don't put speaking and writing as a focus initially. Put a lot of focus on listening, because he's saying acquisition of language, similar to the way first language is learned at home. In the first language learning, writing comes last. Writing is not at all focused. Writing becomes a negative process. Listening becomes comedy. Govardhan, can you mute yourself unless you want to share? Can you mute yourself, Govardhan? Yeah. So the skill, one of the problems in English teaching in school is we focus too much on the skill of production without adequate emphasis on the listening, on the immersion. So before the child is expected to produce language, whether as speech and whether as in written form, it's most important to give children a lot of opportunities to keep on listening and keep on acquiring, keep on immersing them in language. Yeah. Anybody else wants to talk?
Sir.
Pradeep, go ahead. Pradeep and Fauzia. Pradeep first, then Fauzia. Pradeep, go ahead.
Sir, I am Pradeep, sir.
Yeah, Pradeep, go ahead.
The long period of silence, is how it is going to help in acquisition, sir?
Yeah, long period of silence you interpret in the opposite way, which is don't put pressure on the child to produce. So long period of silence really means, see what happens in our classrooms, you all would have also had the experience, many of you had the experience, you make the child stand up in the class and you tell the child, start telling me something. And you see the child is frozen, the child freezes. You can see fear on the child's face. The child's face becomes red, the child doesn't talk. This is familiar, that process we see in our classrooms. The Krashen, what he says when he says long period of silences, he's saying don't force the child to speak. Language should become a process of joy and happiness, expression in the classroom, not one of punishment, not one of fear. And when we force the child to express, when we force the child to produce in the classroom, whether in the oral form or in a written form, that can create a negative environment of fear in the child's mind, which comes in the way of the child acquiring the language. So long period of silence, we can interpret it to mean, let the child speak when the child is ready. Don't prematurely put pressure on the child to speak. A teacher has to be sensitive. Of course, you have to encourage, you have to persuade, you have to cajole the child to speak. I'm not saying you should not do any of that, but this cajoling and persuasion should not become a process by which the process becomes one of fear. We have seen fear in the classroom. Fear is the biggest enemy of language action. Hypothesis, we will go to that also. So when the child becomes fearful of expressing in the language, you have lost your battle. The child is not going to speak English at all. The child is not going to like English at all. So long period of silence means you speak, you keep on speaking. You speak things which are relevant and meaningful for the child. The child will speak back to you when the child is ready. Okay. Fauzia, I wanted to say something. Fauzia, you wanted to say something?
Sir, can I, sir?
Krishna Kumari, go ahead.
Sir, yeah, I do believe that acquisition is the best way for acquiring second language too. But what happens in the most of the primary schools is only the teacher taking English, she only create the atmosphere in the classroom, which is most important for acquisition. So it is becoming difficult to create more language atmosphere in the classroom.
I didn't understand. So English teacher is creating English environment in the classroom. That is
only
good.
Yeah.
So
what is, only English teacher is transacting in English. Most teachers avoid to talk in English, even though it is English medium. So in our Telangana, some of the schools have started in English medium, sir. So from the government side, there is a little support, and the teachers, most of the teachers don't want to take the English class, English medium class. They mostly want to go to Telugu medium only. So yeah, there is a lack of,
sir, if I'm not proper training, can I share my view?
One second, sir. Let her finish, then you can share. Let Krishna Kumari finish.
So there is a hurdle, sir, to create the atmosphere. Those only interested are creating the transaction in English only. Other teachers are simply, they are saying some rhyming words. I'm not saying negative about
it.
Mostly it is happening. So it is the hurdle. Yeah. I'm not blaming anyone, sir. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, one second before. Yeah, thank you, Krishna Kumari. Before Anantha, one important Anantha Mani speaks. One important point I want to make here is, Krishan is saying provide lot of opportunities for the child to listen to English. And what Krishna Kumari's point is, these opportunities are being for the English school. Unfortunately, sir, although sir, one second. I'll complete, then you can speak. One second, sir. I'm just interpreting it. Then immediately after that, you can speak. Give me a minute only. So, the being made is that our teaching school, but mostly maybe speaking in the first language, Telugu or Kannada as the case may be. My suggestion to Krishna Kumari and to others is, there are some things which are under our control. There are some things which are beyond our control. So, as far as the interaction the other teachers have with the children, we may not have too much control on that, because we certainly may not be in a position to go and dictate to them that they should speak in English. So, then your point is valid. Entire scope of English interaction is limited to the English class. It is not at home. It's not in other classes. But doesn't matter. In your own class, if you follow these principles, it will help the child acquire English, compared to in, you know, focusing on the learning processes. So my response to Krishna Kumari is, of course, other teachers may be helpful to the process, may not be helpful to the process, doesn't matter. That is not under control. What is under your control is your own classroom. And if you focus on providing adequate opportunities for the children to express and interact in English, that will help the child better than if you are to focus on the structure of language rather than the meaning. Yes, Anantha Mani, go ahead.
So we teach all other subjects in the instruction language, that is our first language, sir. We have to spend more time for English, that is for classroom instructions, and while they are playing, while they are eating, we have to do English. Only the practice make them perfect, sir. So my suggestion is we spend more time for English.
Yeah, that is true. So more time you spend, obviously it will help in language learning quicker, because see, the child has advantage when the child is learning the first language at home. The child has spent 5 years listening to Kannada or 5 years listening to Telugu. You are not going to get that time in your school that you cannot tell 5 years the child will listen to English, then the child will start speaking English, because you don't have so much time. You have maybe 1 year at a time with you. But even in that 1 year, the more opportunities you give to the child to engage in English, the better for the child. There's no doubt about that. But it is possible for the children to acquire English. Krishan's hypothesis is, if instead of focusing on learning processes, you focus on acquisition processes, which are similar to the processes of...
Sir, can I, sir?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Sir, language is actually linked up with the culture, sir. Unless the learner is exposed to the language more and more, the medium of instruction doesn't help, actually. We may know that most of the good speakers at English are from either Kannada, Tamil or Telugu medium background. Why? Because they might have exposed more and more to the English language. We cannot separate of the culture and the language. As we know that the mother tongue will be caught, not taught. If language is caught, that takes acquisition. If language learns, that becomes learning, sir. Actually, a teacher may not make the learner to 100% of good speaker of English. That's my opinion, sir. Actually, we have to discharge our duties, but rest of the things is they have to expose to the language more and more. Unless the that's why we in these days are some for the last 10 years we are learning discourse oriented pedagogy. Language exists in the form of discourses, no sir. I believe that language will be enriched by the discourse. As he exposed to the more and more discourses, he will become very perfect. That is my view, sir.
That is what Krashen is also saying. So, Govardhan, what you are saying is what I have been explaining, that when you say discourse, discourse is important part of language learning. That is what Krashen is saying, that see, culture and language are certainly correlated, and that's why naturally the child which comes to your classroom who is rooted in Telugu can speak Telugu. But that does not mean we should say English cannot be learnt. English is not the natural culture of the child, but in your English classroom, you can create an English culture. By English culture need not be American English or British English. It's an Indian English culture. It's a Telangana English culture. It's a Karnataka English culture that you can build. And you create the discourse space in your classroom. So the discourse space, what Krashen says, discourse means meaning. It should be meaningful for the child. So that's the second point he's saying. If you are able to engage the child in meaningful conversations in your classroom, where there is not pressure on the child to perform, the child will acquire English. That is what is Krashen's hypothesis. And so I am suggesting to all of you that you look at your own ways of teaching. Forget what other teachers do. That's not under your control. Forget what is happening at home. That is not under your control. You might encourage the parents to talk with the child in English, but really beyond a point, it may not work because the parents may not know English. But Krashen is saying, in your classroom, can you provide opportunities for meaningful immersion? What Govardhan talked about as discourse, can you create a discourse in the classroom which is meaningful for the child, which is not fearful for the child, where there are multiple ways in which the child is listening to language? It will help the child acquire language over time. Okay, so let's go to the next hypothesis. So the next hypothesis is called the input hypothesis. Input hypothesis is very connected to acquisition. So I hope you are all able to see input hypothesis. So in input hypothesis, the points that the lot of scope for peer learning, if you encourage students to talk amongst themselves in English and encourage them to talk with one another, even if they make mistakes. So the issue, as the already in the acquisition hypothesis, is that fluency is more important than accuracy. If the classroom becomes a place where people feel, even if I make mistakes, okay, I can talk in English, that is the input hypothesis. Provide lots of opportunities for the child to acquire, to listen to it. So you have to give input to the children, and discourse, the process of discourse making, as Govardhan said, is an important part of that. So you create discourses for the child to become familiar with the language. And low or no emphasis on production, silent period, already we have discussed. Mechanical drill is not a good process. So that's why we put a cross there. The more we make English learning as a process of mechanical drill, repeat the sentence 10 times, write this sentence 20, write this spelling mistake 100 times. I have written dictation, you make a spelling mistake, you write it 100 times. You may write it 100 times and you may become familiar with that spelling, but you will start hating the language. So it's a very important job of the English teacher not to allow the child to get into a relationship with English where the child feels, I don't want English. It's very mechanical. There is no meaning. There is no joy. So meaning and joy are connected. When I find meaning in something, it's a process of joy for me. Whenever something is meaningless, it becomes dull, dry, and therefore I don't engage with it. So therefore, the focus in input hypothesis, which goes with acquisition, is the teachers, if language is acquired by the child through informal processes, which is acquisition hypothesis, the input hypothesis says provide a lot of opportunities for the child to listen to language, which so the child is getting a lot of input from the teacher. The child is also getting a lot of input from others in the room. And the caretaker hypothesis basically is that if you are the caretaker of a child, the caretaker is always concerned with the immediate requirements of the child. So that is the meaning of a caretaker. So a caretaker speech is one where the speech is simply aimed at supporting the child's needs. So that is what is connected to the idea of meaning making. Whatever the caretaker is going to talk to the child will be only items that are definitely meaningful for the child's own life. So that is called caretaker language. So caretaker is not going to talk something which is completely abstract, which is completely decontextualized from the child's life. So that is the input hypothesis. The input hypothesis goes along with the acquisition hypothesis. Acquisition hypothesis says language is acquired gradually by the child when it's immersed in language. Input hypothesis says the teacher's job is to provide a lot of input to the child. You have to speak to the child in English. So it is not therefore the complete translation approach where the teacher simply translate and speak to the child not in English but in the local language. That's not a good approach to help the child learn English. So if I'm a teacher of English or I'm a teacher of mathematics and I'm teaching the entire content of the textbook in Telugu or Kannada instead of in English and I don't speak in English at all, then that is not good because then it fails the input hypothesis of Krashen. Okay, any questions so far, any questions or comments? We will go and look at the other three hypotheses as well, but before that, if there are any questions, please share. Yeah, if there are any questions or comments from anybody? Hitesh sir is typing. Hitesh sir, would you like to speak? Would you like to unmute and share your thoughts?
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, sir.
No, I'm not talking to you. Actually, somebody, Pauzia Begum has said something she wants to share. Don't do this right now. Please attend the class. And after this, you can talk to in the group. Pauzia Begum, please don't do all yes. these things when you are attending a class. That is very important class for all of you, right? Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Hitesh sir. Yeah. So Fauzia madam, we can look at that later on. What we are doing, we can share it in the WhatsApp group. Right. So let us focus on the ideas that Krashen is suggesting for helping us make our classrooms more comfortable for English teaching learning. Yeah, anybody has any comment or any doubt or any suggestion about the acquisition hypothesis as well as on the input hypothesis? Anybody else wants to share? Anybody wants to speak about these?
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, Suchitra, go ahead.
So what is meant by free conversation, not comprehensible?
Yeah, so Krashen is saying that you have to provide a lot of input to the children by speaking to them a lot. So Razia said that in the beginning, and that's what we are talking about in the acquisition and input, that the child has to be immersed in the language. That immersion should make sure that the child understands. So free conversation is, sometimes we may be talking something, we know the child is not understanding. It may be unfortunate that, let's say you're teaching class 7 and you're teaching class 7 English textbook and you're speaking from the textbook. You know very well that maybe 10% of the children of the class are not understanding anything that you're saying. So although you're providing input to the children in terms of speaking English to them, but your conversation is really not meaningful for them. So it is not comprehensible. So Krashen says, if you're speaking in English to the children, however, they don't understand what you're saying, that is not going to be input. So that is why a cross is put there. Input to the children has to be such that it is meaningful for them. They're able to understand it. They may not understand 100% of it, but if they should be able to understand at least 90-80% of it, then the 10-20% they will try to bridge by guessing what some words may mean. But if 90% of what you're speaking, they don't understand, although you are inputting them by speaking in English, they are not going to acquire English. That is the point. Is that okay? Is that clear? That's what is meant by free conversation. Simply talking to them in English, when you know that they are not understanding what you're saying, is not going to help them in acquiring English. It has to be meaningful for them. They have to make sense of it. Okay. So the next hypothesis is extremely important, which is called the affective filter hypothesis. What Krashen says is affective filter, it's a filter, it stops. A filter, we know, allows some things to pass and prevents some things from passing. That is the meaning of a filter. So affective filter means the psychological state of the child has a role to play in language learning. If the psychological state of the child is one of confidence, it's one of positivity, the child is going to acquire the language. However, if the affective state, the mental state of the child is one of fear, one of non-comprehension, one of stress, the child is not going to acquire the language. So it is very, very important that language classrooms, English classrooms, have to be one where there is least amount of stress or fear. And if there is stress or fear in the classroom, the particular child which is stressed or anxious is not going to learn. So you have to make sure in your classroom, as you're practicing English with the children, as you're immersing children with your use of English, you're compelling them to produce. You are not creating an environment of anxiety or fear in the children. You are creating an environment there. It's okay. Even if I make mistakes, teacher is not going to scold me. Teacher is not going to punish me. But if I make an effort to speak in English, the teacher is going to be happy. And teacher is not going to put pressure of expectation that I must produce, which itself will cause anxiety in me. So input hypothesis is a positive thing. It is about more and more input being given to the children, which is positive, which is meaningful for the children. Effective filter is a negative part, which is the more the effective filter, the less the possibility the child will learn. So in your own classrooms, you have to increase the input and you have to reduce the effective filter. That is the hypothesis of Krashen. Do the changing of teachers and schools in different classes affect the acquisition? So Umar's point is connected to effective filter. We all know that when the environment changes, the anxiety is created. So every time, you know, I remember my own classes, first day of school was always a stressful experience. Although I know that I'm going to be with my friends who I was studying the previous year, the first day of the new year is always one of anxiety for the children. Similarly, if you take a child and change the class with the child is with new children, with new people, and therefore the anxiety is there. If a teacher changes, anxiety is there. That's why we have some concept of a class teacher who's there for a lot of time with the child. And that's why many times the same teacher teaches the child across classes. So that familiarity and the relationship with the child creates an environment of security and lack of fear. But when the environment of security, when the environment of confidence, when the environment of non-stress environment is not there, when the environment is stressful or anxious or fearful, then it will affect the learning of the child. It will affect the ability of the child to acquire language. We all know, you make a child stand up to answer something, the child stops thinking, the child is unable to think, the child is unable to speak, and that is where the effective filter is blocking the learning. This is what is hypothesis of Krashen. Is that clear? Any comments? So the learning from this point is, each of you have to ensure that in your classroom, the child is not afraid. There is no fear in the child. You are not disciplining the child by using fear, by using punishment. The punishment can be verbal punishment. The punishment can be something that the child has to do. Stand up on the bench, write something 20 times, go outside the classroom. Anytime you create anxiety in the children, Krashen's hypothesis says, language acquisition is going to become more difficult for the child. Yes, so that is what Dada Sahib, that's what Krashen says. The emotional state of the child has a role to play in acquiring language. See, something about science or social science, the child can probably memorize. The child can, you know, mug up something and produce it in the exam. But language is not content. We already explained, discussed earlier that if we treat English as a content, we are going to be failing in building communication skills. So communication skills cannot be built in an environment of fear. Mugging something and producing in the exam is possible even with fear, but communication is not possible. Therefore, in the English classroom, fear should not be there. Govardhan, would you like to say something? We are not able to hear you, Govardhan. If you want to speak, unmute and talk.
No, sir.
Okay, fine. Anybody wants to say anything? How in your own classrooms do you see that fear operates? That fear becomes something that prevents the child from expressing themselves. Have you seen it in your classrooms or other rooms?
Excuse me, sir.
Cyril, go ahead. Anuradha, go ahead. Anuradha, go ahead.
Told that input hypothesis is a positive one, where we give more and more practice on listening, not practice. We'll explore the child to listen first. But can you please explain how it is negative, sir? Effective filter hypothesis.
Effective filter negative, what I mean is, effective filter says that if the child is anxious in the classroom, that emotional state becomes a barrier to learning. So in that sense, it is negative. Effective filter, effective, the negative state of the child's mind. Negative state of the child's mind means child is anxious, child is fearful, child is unhappy, child is sad. If these negative emotions are a part of the child's mental makeup in the classroom, maybe because the teacher is pointing out, like Narmada says, if you make a child stand up and point out the mistake of the child feels humiliated, the child feels ashamed. When that kind of a negative emotional state is there with the child's ability to learn the language declines rapidly. So input is a positive thing where you're giving experiences to the child to listen to language in a meaningful manner. That is the input hypothesis. That's a positive thing. Effective filter is when the child, the environment in the classroom is fearful, negative, anxious, and not conducive to learning. So the teacher has to build an environment in the classroom where there is lack of stress, where there is no anxiety, where children feel I can speak in English, even if I make mistakes, I'm not going to be punished. But the teacher can correct me. I'm not telling you should not correct the children. But when you correct the children, you correct them in a way that they don't feel stress or fear from that. Umar is saying felt high level in Malayalam medium than English medium. Can you explain, Umar? I didn't understand your point. Can you elaborate? Can you unmute and talk? Umar, can you unmute and talk? What do you mean by your point? I didn't understand your point. Has Umar logged in the mic mode? No, Umar is in the audio only mode. So Umar, can you type and explain what you mean? So yes, Dada Sahib is saying highly engaging and varied teaching materials and styles is very important. But effective filter says keep the environment stress-free. You may have 20 materials, you may have 5 materials, you may have 10 materials. More materials means more input. So that is the input hypothesis. Effective hypothesis says do not create an environment of fear and stress. The next hypothesis, the monitor hypothesis, says that every child, when the child is learning the language, there is a monitor, psychological monitor. Lakshmi, mute your mic, please. The monitor child, which is governing what the child is saying. So the child is automatically monitoring his or her own expression. So Krashen says, if the monitor is too strong, then the child will be diffident to express. So hypothesis says that monitor in the child is very strong, the child his or her own expression in English, and they will be very conscious of making mistakes. So that is a monitor hypothesis. On the other hand, if the monitor is weak, then the child will freely express even if the child makes mistakes. So what Krashen is saying is monitor should be at the ideal level. Ideal level means it is not so strong that it prevents the child from expressing. At the same time, it is not so weak that the child expresses freely without making mistakes. But if you look at the acquisition learning hypothesis, initially the monitor should be very weak. The child's monitor inside the child should be very weak. The teacher as a monitor should be very weak. Teacher should not do too much of monitoring role in the beginning. When the monitor is less, whether within the child or in the classroom, the monitoring is less, the ability to freely express is more. And gradually, as the child becomes more and more comfortable, the monitor can become stronger, where the child is able to assess her own mistakes as the child is talking. So that is called the monitor hypothesis. Okay. The last hypothesis, the natural order hypothesis, where Krashen says that language learning, certain structures of language are learned before other structures, and therefore the teacher can focus more on them. But he says still, if there is a natural order also, more important than that is meaningful interactions with the child in the classroom environment. Okay. So this is what are the 5 hypotheses of Krashen. If there are any questions or comments, we can look at that. I just want to show you a couple of principles based on what he has said, which are, you know, if you were to ask in a nutshell, what is Krashen's hypothesis? It are these 2 principles. I would like somebody to read them. Can Vidya unmute and read these 2 principles, which in a way sum up the entire 5 hypotheses of Krashen's, can be summed up in these 2 principles. Vidya, can you unmute and read out?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Acquisition requires meaningful interaction in the target language. Natural communication in which speakers are concerned not with the form of their utterances, but with the messages they are conveying and understanding. Second one, language acquisition does not require extensive use of conscious grammatical rules and does not require tedious drill.
You are now unmuted.
Hello.
Sorry, I was talking when I was in the mute mode. So I was saying that the first principle says that acquisition requires meaningful interaction in the target language. So in your classrooms, it's your responsibility to make sure that whatever interactions you're having with the students, they're actually able to make some sense of it vis-a-vis their lives. So meaning making is not simply that I know what the meaning of the word daffodil is. It's a flower which is yellow in color, but I don't know what a daffodil is. I've never experienced a daffodil in my life. So I had daffodils in school and I couldn't understand what it meant. It might have been a very beautiful, powerful poem by Wordsworth, but it left me cold because I couldn't make any sense of it. Or The Solitary Reaper, again by Wordsworth. I didn't know what The Solitary Reaper meant. Also because I came from urban background and my urban background did not allow me to connect at all to, you know, reaping and singing in the field. I could not make what sense that made. So English teaching for you, the first step is, can you engage with the children in meaningful interactions in the target language, which is English? Natural communication. So the focus of Crashen is, let the communication be natural communication. What does that mean? Speakers are concerned not with the form of the utterance, not with the format, not with the sentence structure, not with the pronunciation. Sentence structure rules of grammar and pronunciation, they are all the form of language. And Crashen says, form of language should come later on, after language is acquired. So instead of being concerned with the form of language, you are concerned with the meaning that is being conveyed by the child and conveyed to the child by the teacher. And therefore, language acquisition does not require extensive use of conscious grammatical rules and does not require tedious drill. Now, Crashen's acquisition learning hypothesis says that learning is also important, but learning should come after acquisition processes have fairly succeeded. If the child has acquired English, then the child is ready for engaging with the structure of language and grammar and drill. But what do we do in our schools, which is why children develop an aversion to English, is before we have put in effort to make sure that they have acquired language, they are comfortable in language, we have immersed them in language, we have created a fear-free environment in the classroom, we engage them in drill, we give them exercises where they have to do the same thing repetitively multiple times. We focus on grammar, we focus on writing, and this creates an aversion to the process of acquiring language. And that is why our children are not comfortable with English. A large part of our children's failure in English is also dependent on the way we teach in faulty ways. And that is what is Crashen's hypothesis, which is why it is useful for us to understand. Yeah. Any questions or comments? I think we can... maybe after a few minutes, we'll discuss it and we can take a short break and come again. So this is basically to understand Crashen's hypothesis. We started at 10:30, it is 11. It's going to be 12 now. So it's around 1.5 hours. Anything anybody wants to comment on? Yes, Dr. Hitesh, sir, go ahead.
Sir, you can continue up to 12:45. No problem.
Okay, sir. Thank you. I was thinking maybe a 2-minute break for people may be good.
Once the break, their attention will get diverted. No problem.
Okay. Yes. So we'll go on till 12:45. Any comments or questions on what you have covered so far? So Crashen is telling us some ideas which may be relevant to the way we teach English in the schools. Crashen's point is acquisition processes are very important, which is replicating the way the child has acquired the first language at home, which is an environment free of fear, free of anxiety, where there's a lot of immersion in the language because the teacher is creating multiple input opportunities for the child to acquire language, where the monitor is not strong enough to prevent the child from expressing, where there's a period of long silence where the expectation from the child is kept to the minimum. If we are able to adhere to these processes, slowly we will find that the children become comfortable in expressing themselves in English, even if they make mistakes. And gradually, as they become more and more confident of the speaking, once fluency is established, then they can focus on accuracy, which is a part of the learning hypothesis, where there's a focus on structure of language, where there's a focus on rules of grammar, where there's a focus on vocabulary. All that comes later on, but that is after a foundation of basic competency in the language is built through the acquisition process. That is Crashen's hypothesis. Yeah. Anything else? Anybody, any comments, any disagreement, any experiences that you would like to share?
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, Narmada, go ahead.
Sir, I think among the hypothesis theories, fourth one is monitor hypothesis. Can you name the fifth one?
Yeah. Yeah, so what Krashen means by the natural order hypothesis, he's saying that when you learn a language, some things are learned before other things. We all know that verbs are learned first, right? Mostly when you learn a language, the first few things that you learn are essentially verbs: eating, speaking, sleeping, bathing, walking. So some structures, some components of the language are learned before other components. So that is called the natural order. So one can focus, what are the things that children will learn first? Those components of language can be focused on first, and then certain others, for example, abstract ideas, abstract nouns. These are the kind of things that one might learn later on. So that is called the natural order. So he says that whatever be the language, need not be English, it can be English, it can be Telugu, it can be Malayalam. As a teacher in Telangana, for you, Malayalam may be a second language that you are learning. So in the order of, in language learning, the components of language have a particular structure. And the details of that he has explained in a book of his, which I will give a reference to you. You can go through that to understand what is the sequencing he's suggesting. But he also says sequencing is not so important. Meaning making is very important. So he suggests that don't worry too much about the order of learning. So long as you're able to keep the process, the experience meaningful for the children, the acquisition of language will happen. So that is the last hypothesis, which is a natural hypothesis, natural order hypothesis. Yeah, so I'll try to get the whole concept map visible now. Let us see if we can see the entire concept map at one time. Yeah, are you all able to see the entire concept map?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so this is the entire concept map. Any questions or comments on any of these points, we can discuss. Anybody wants to say anything? Anybody has a doubt? Anybody has a question? Anybody disagrees? This is hypothesis. If you see what Krashen calls this, he doesn't call it Krashen's laws of English language learning. He doesn't call it a law. He says it's a hypothesis. Hypothesis means it's his belief that these things will work. So it is not necessary it works all the time. It's not necessary it works 100% of the time. But if you follow
this hypothesis,
it can be true or false, but obviously he's suggesting to you because he believes in them. He's not suggesting to you as 50% true, 50% false, but he's saying we don't need to treat it as a law. We can treat it as a hypothesis, which we can try it out in our classroom. Yeah. Anything else? Anybody else wants to say something, comment on it, disagree, agree? Yes, hypotheses are correlated, Dada Sahib. Of course, they're correlated. The input and acquisition are correlated. The input and effective filter are correlated. Effective filter and monitor are correlated. So all the hypotheses, obviously, they're not independent hypotheses. They are related, but they are distinct.
You are now unmuted.
Yes, Ramya, you want to say something? Go ahead.
Yes, Ramya, you want to say something? Go ahead.
Speaking and grammar classes, but children are inhibited to speak English language because they are not sure about the grammar structure, everything like that. So how to make the child to speak in English without inhibition? What a teacher can do?
Okay, Ramya, can you mute yourself? Kavita, you want to speak? Ramya, please mute yourself. Kavita, go ahead.
Ramya,
respond to Ramya after Kavita
speaks.
Kavita, go ahead. Kavita, you want to say something? Okay, I think Kavita muted a mistake. Sikandrama, would you like to speak? Go ahead.
Yes, sir. I accept our mistake, sir. Whenever the first standard student come to class, we teach usually the letters and reading and writing. We don't give much more opportunities to listen English because we had also a pressure our superiors. After 3 months, we inspect them, they dictate. One or two persons write correctly, they underestimate our teaching. So only we give a more importance to write and read. We didn't give more.
That's very true, Sikandrama. I think you have said it very appropriately that when the child is coming to class one, see, I'm making a strong statement. It may apply to some of us, it may not apply to all of us. Children don't learn language because of the faulty teaching methods followed in our schools. I'm making that statement very consciously, not only from my experiences of my own language learning in my school, but also from reading about language learning and working with language teachers in schools. We work with language teachers in schools, and I can say with some amount of conviction that children can acquire English, but our methods of teaching are faulty. They may be because the fault may be because we get pressurized by our superiors. We are forced to prove that children have learned in a particular period of time. Whatever be the reason, it may also be the problem that we ourselves have experienced faulty teaching methods. So when we were in school ourselves, we experienced language teaching in a particular way where the focus was on grammar. For example, Ramya, grammar is the enemy of acquisition. So let me put it very bluntly. When the process of acquiring language is concerned, meaning making is more important than correctness. As he says, structure is not important. Accuracy is not important. Fluency is important. Whatever language you have learned, you will remember that first you try to become fluent. If all the time you are worried about being correct, you will never speak. It is only when you give up. If you take my own example, I learned Kannada after I came to Karnataka. I am from Bombay. I grew up in Bombay. I learned Marathi as my third language in school. I never spoke Marathi because Marathi was taught as a subject. It was taught as content to me by my Marathi teacher. I never acquired confidence to speak in Marathi. But when I came to Karnataka and I started working with the Kannada teachers, I realized I had to learn Kannada. I could learn Kannada only because I was not afraid of making mistakes, and nobody was there to correct me, nobody was there to punish me, nobody was there to teach me grammar of Kannada. My focus was I have to become fluent in expressing myself in Kannada. And therefore, even though I made mistakes, my friends did not tease me, my friends did not harass me, my friends did not punish me. They encouraged me. They said, it's okay, even if you make mistake, you speak. And it is because the effective filter of Kannada speaking was low for me, that environment of fear or stress was less. Nobody tried to teach me grammar before I wanted to speak Kannada. I could actually build the ability to speak Kannada. Even Dr. Hitesh, who is a polyglot, he is so comfortable in different languages. I'm sure he acquired competence and comfort in Tamil and Kannada because nobody was focusing on grammar with respect to him. So even with respect to your own lives, when you have learned a second language, you would have learned it by watching TV, by watching films, and that environment of acquisition where you're listening a lot to the language without focus on structure, without focus on grammar, without fear, that's how you learn. So Ramya, the answer for you is very simple. Grammar is the enemy of acquisition. Grammar is the important part of learning, but learning has to follow acquisition. If basic comfort in expressing in the language is not there, and we do premature focus on grammar, we do premature focus on writing, we do premature focus on alphabets. For example, Sikandrama's point is very important, which is that it has been established world over that the worst way to teach language is to start with alphabets. That's how I learned language in school. I was taught A, B, C, D in English. I was taught A, I, E for Hindi. So the first time you start teaching language and you focus on alphabet, it's most meaningless for the child. The child has no idea what the alphabet is. The child doesn't care about the script because script and language are different things. We know that reading and writing are different skills. Listening, speaking is different from reading, writing. The script is different from the language. So in class one, if Sikandrama is able to engage the children in speaking English and experiencing natural experiences, talking to them about what is happening in their home, talking to them about their own relationships in their home with their mother, their father, with the activities that their parents do, their siblings do, what they saw when they came to the school, what happened in a festival. If all these discussions are happening in English in the class one classroom also, that is going to help the child acquire English much more than teaching the child alphabets, much more than teaching the child spellings or words or structure of language in primary school. Don't mistake me, I'm not saying grammar is not important. I'm not saying structure is not important, but Krashen's hypothesis, if you see the mind map, acquisition comes before learning, and grammar and structure are a part of learning. They are not a part of acquisition. So this is what I just opened learning as well. So what Krashen says is acquisition has to precede learning, and our faulty teaching methods in our schools ensure that our children never acquire the language. And especially it is true for English, because English is an alien language in many ways. It is not phonetic. The structures are different from Indian languages. So a Telugu child can easily learn Kannada, but compared to that, English is much more difficult. But English teachers make that job much worse by faulty teaching methods. So that is the whole point. So Nusrat Banu is also saying that primary level, children make fun. Yeah, the minute you make fun of children, then you are creating a negative emotional environment that is called the what he calls as the the affective filter. So you have to encourage children not to make fun of one another, and you have to make it a happy experience. If English speaking in the classroom becomes a happy experience where there is no fear, where mistakes can be made, where there is no focus on grammar and structure and correctness and on vocabulary and pronunciation, the child will begin acquiring English. Once the child becomes fairly fluent, then structure, grammar, vocabulary, phonetics, all of them can come in. That is the basic hypothesis of Krashen. It has an influence on the way you can teach English in your classroom. Now, if you're a class one teacher, certainly you should follow acquisition processes. But even if you're a class seven teacher and you find that your children, although they're in class seven, they have no much idea of English, then you have to stress on acquisition even in class seven. Ideally, in class seven, you should be focusing on learning. But if your children have no prior comfort with English, then unfortunately, you have to start with acquisition, because acquisition precedes learning. Yeah, so as Shargi says, continuous communication makes anyone to be fluent. That is important. So continuous communication is the input hypothesis. Input is essential for fluency, but you have to create situations. Those situations have to be meaningful situations for the children. It can be a drama. It doesn't have to only always be festival or home or anything. It can be a drama. You can do a small drama, but it is something that is of meaning for the child. That's important. Okay. Any questions? Anybody wants to share something? Anybody wants to comment on what I have said? Sir? Anybody disagrees with what I'm saying? Yes. Yes, Vadivu, go ahead.
Sir, yes, most of the students in our class can be able to understand our English, sir. But, hello?
Yeah, go ahead, Vadivu, we can hear you.
But they hesitate to reply in English, sir. That's a major problem, one of the major problems in our class, sir.
That is true. That is what, if you see long period of silence, can you see, Vadivu, on the screen? That long period of silence means, if children are comfortable listening to English, give them time. They will come and start speaking in English. Don't force them to speak in English. Don't create anxiety in them to speak in English. If they're understanding what you're saying and you keep on talking to them in English, you should not talk to them in Telugu. You should not talk to them in Kannada or Malayalam. As an English teacher, you continue talking to them in English, but make sure they understand what you're saying. Then over a period of time, they will start communicating in English. That is a Krashen hypothesis.
Yeah.
Don't be anxious that it is taking time. Don't be anxious. Even in your home, some children start speaking at 9 months, some children don't speak even at 2 years, right? We don't make it an anxious situation. You're not speaking, please speak now. The child will never speak. So, Vadivu, the teacher's job is, don't make classroom environment anxiety filled for the children. If they're not speaking, don't mind. They can talk to you in Tamil, they can talk to you in Kannada, no problem. You speak to them in English. Your job is to create the English environment. So you should talk to them in English. But if they are taking time in talking to you in English, doesn't matter. Yeah, who wants to speak? Keep your mic muted unless you want to speak. Kalpana and then Praveena. First, Kalpana.
Sir, we must know language based on skills, isn't it, sir? Not based on knowledge.
Yes, language is listening, reading, writing are all skills only, you know. So knowledge is the secondary part. Meaning making is important. So the activity, it's not important. Daffodils is not important. Solitary reaper is not important. Coromandel fishers is not important. Palanquin bearers is not important. What is important is the interaction is meaningful for the child. So that is very important. Yeah, who else wanted to speak? Kalpana, you finished? Anything else you want to say? Yes, Praveena, go ahead. Yeah, thanks, Kalpana. Praveena, go ahead.
The fluency is the natural speed of speaking, sir. So what we make is making children reading video makes the class magnifying, sir. We play many videos and audios so that children will be perfect by listening and they are fluent in speaking also, sir.
Yeah, very important thing, Praveena. It should be meaningful video for the child. So why do children love cartoons? Children, you don't have to tell children to watch cartoon. You put a cartoon, children immediately watch it. They find some meaning in that process. I'm not telling you should show cartoons in the school. But what I'm trying to tell Praveena is, videos and audio certainly add to the process of fluency skill in the children, certainly. But show videos and audio that is meaningful for them. Don't show something that is not meaningful yes, for sir. Them, which is we what. Which is that, you know, free conversation, not. Yeah. If you see the bottom of the screen, there is a point says free conversation, not comprehensible, right? So even if you are showing a video or an audio, it should be such that the children are able to make sense of it. So free conversation, which is not comprehensible, is not meaningful. In the same way, videos which are not meaningful also will not build fluency. Yeah, but I'm not saying you are. I'm just cautioning that it's very important to keep that in mind. Yeah, anybody else wants to say something? Somebody else also wanted to talk, I think. Yeah, Fauzia is very rich. Yeah, one second. Fauzia, inductive approach is very important. So inductive approach is the immersion, and gradually through meaningful activities of the children, in an inductive manner, children acquire the language. Yes, Srinivas, please go ahead. Srinivas, then Hare Krishna. Srinivas, then Hare Krishna.
Sir, in natural way, hypothesis, is it, can we put the natural language input like skits, can we adopt that method in our classroom? Is it good for to acquire naturally in the English language?
Yeah, natural hypothesis means that when you're teaching English, focus on some aspects first and then on the other aspects. You can read the book to get details of what he's talking about. So you can focus on basically, but he says meaning making is most important. So that's why meaning making means verbs automatically come in, because initially the expressions that we use are to do with the concrete world around us, right? So our interactions with the concrete world around us has to trigger the use of language in the classroom. So that is what Krashen is saying. So Narmada is absolutely right. Teacher's attitude is very important. Teacher's attitude is a make or break for the children to acquire the language. If teacher is going to focus on teaching English as a subject, create environment of fear in the classroom, not allow adequate opportunities for the child to listen to language, the teacher has failed. But where the teacher is allowing children to explore language freely without worrying about making mistakes, but teacher is providing a lot of input opportunities for the children, the teacher will help the child succeed. So teacher's attitude and teacher's approach is very, very important for learning language. I would say it's the most important thing. You cannot control the home environment. You cannot control the environment in the other classrooms, but you can control your classroom environment, and that will help you determine the child's success. Your child's success depends on you. Your child's failure depends on you. And that is the way you're teaching the language. So Krashen's focus is try to look at the way acquisition processes work and try to use them in your classroom. Yeah, anybody else wants to say anything?
Sir.
Yeah.
Can I speak? Go ahead. Sir.
Go ahead, Santoshamma.
Sir, acquiring fluency is important than committing mistakes, no, sir? According to Krashen's
yes.
says that acquisition precedes learning. In
yes.
our class, I have take one activity daily in the prayer, sir. I used to make the make 2 to 3 children to participate in role play, sir.
Yes.
It may be helpful in acquiring this acquisition, sir, hypothesis.
Yes. Did they enjoy when they do the role play? Do they enjoy what they're doing?
Yeah, yeah, sir. All classes will enjoy in that.
Yeah, so that is an example of an activity which is meaningful for the children as well as not anxiety based. So therefore, that's an activity where children can really focus on learning. So I'm just sharing on the screen now. If you see TCall activities, TCall is a program that my organization, I'm working in an NGO called IT for Change. And IT for Change works with government schools and government aided schools in Bangalore, and we are Bangalore based. We do work with English language teachers also. So to bring into practice Krashen's hypothesis, we have worked with English teachers to make them more confident to introduce some of these activities. So you can see that on the screen. So conversation on specific topics, group storytelling, role plays, seeing short videos, peer reading, group reading, digital storytelling. These are all some of the activities that we have engaged in the classroom. And the outcome of that, below that you can see in the outcome, it has certainly helped the children to become less inhibited and more engaged in learning language. Their desire to learn language has increased. Earlier, we would not find children on their own coming to us and telling, we want to learn this, we want to do that, please help. But we found out that children themselves come to us and say, can you help me with this? I want to learn this. So children's desire to learn language increased because of these processes that we practiced in the classroom. So they started completing their homework. So we tried to make language learning a joy and fun exploration, interaction without the pressure of performance. And that we found, we were working with class 8 and class 9 children. We found that that process was really helpful for them. So the specifics of the activities you can see on the screen. If you want me to explain anything, I can explain. Otherwise, we have to go to the next activity in our class today. So I'm also having some syllabus here. So I think time for Krashen's hypothesis is more or less over. I would like to introduce to you the idea of making materials. So we'll get into that next. But before that, please go through the screen and look at the TCOL activities. You all can see TCOL activities on the screen now, which is the program that we did in Karnataka, in Bangalore schools. And these are some of the things that we practiced. Yeah, are you all able to see? Any questions? So these are some of the activities that we practiced in the classroom to create an environment of language acquisition. And you can see that there is no grammar in that, there is no dictation in that, there is none of the typical language exercises that many of us do in the schools. There was no focus on dictation or no focus on writing tests, no focus on grammar, but focus on meaningful activities. Yes, Narmada and then Anuradha. Narmada, go ahead. Narmada, Anuradha.
Yeah, we can see the hypothesis slide only, sir.
Sorry, can't hear you. You are not able to see TCOL activities. I can see it.
No, sir. Only happened that questions only.
Okay. What about others? Can other people see TCOL
activities? It is visible, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Visible.
Anuradha, refresh your screen.
Anuradha, yes, sir. Visible.
Yeah. Anuradha, refresh your screen. You can see it. So sometimes screen gets frozen. Just refresh it. Yes, Vijayalakshmi, go ahead.
It is not the visible, sir.
Just you refresh your screen.
The TCOL activity, sir.
Vijayalakshmi, just refresh your screen. If you're using a computer, do Control Shift R. If you're using a computer, do Control Shift R.
No, sir.
If you're seeing on your mobile, log out, log in again, you can see it. If you're on your computer, do Control Shift R. If you're on your phone, do back button and log in again.
Sir?
Yes,
Can you say again about the TCOL? What about what is meant by the TCOL? Yeah, yeah. The abbreviation of TCOL, yeah. Sir?
Yeah. TCOL full form is Teachers Communities of Learning. So it is a name of a program that, NGOs, even in your school and you might have seen in other schools, NGOs, sometimes non-governmental organizations, sometimes come to the school to do a program with the school teachers. So we are also an NGO. We are based in Bangalore. The name of the NGO is IT for Change. So we try to see how we can use IT for improving the teaching learning processes. One of the areas of work that we have been engaging for the last couple of years is English teaching. So we have been working with English teachers as a part of the Teachers Communities of Learning program. Teachers Community of Learning means we try to bring teachers together. So we made a group of English teachers in some 40 schools are there in where we work. So 40 schools, we try to bring the English teachers together to share their experiences, to discuss with one another, to, share resources. For example, you might be making your own materials and somebody mentioned they show videos in the classroom. So those videos can be shared with other teachers also, along with a lesson plan or along with an activity plan. So our idea of Teachers Community of Learning is bring teachers together so you help one another. See, department will conduct programs once in a while, like you're coming in the CLT program, but that cannot be the entirety of your own development effort. So you have to put your own efforts to learning, and part of it is by interacting with other teachers. So that is the basic premise of the TCOL program, that teachers can come together and help one another by sharing their experiences. So in our program, the Bangalore South District teachers, we bring them together, English language teachers. And in some schools, wherever the teacher is interested and is willing to allow us to come to our classroom, because we can only go into the classroom with the permission of the teacher. So we work in some schools where we try to explore Krashen's hypothesis, implementing in the classroom processes. So we explain to the teacher that let us encourage the children to speak. Let us, for example, we had a, in Karnataka state syllabus, there is a chapter on Shantiniketan. So instead of just reading the textbook and trying to understand Shantiniketan, we downloaded videos from the internet where the activities in Shantiniketan, you know, the prayers in the morning or the woodwork and carpentry and painting in the afternoon. The entire day at Shantiniketan, there was a nice video. We showed that video to the children. We did a timeline of Shantiniketan, how it has changed over time. We discussed Rabindranath Tagore with the children by showing a short film on Tagore. So using these kind of activities, and then we asked the children to compare their own school with Shantiniketan, because obviously a typical school is so different from Shantiniketan the way Tagore visualized it. So these kind of activities made the idea of Shantiniketan, an alternate school, much more meaningful for the children. So this is a TCOL program, TCOL activities. Like that, we also encourage children to make their own stories. So the children write their own stories. Children make picture stories. They create some drawings. They put it into some text, try to make stories of that. One of the important projects also was digital storytelling. So we encourage children to go out, interact with, you know, shopkeepers, interact with primary health center, interact with veterinary hospital, post office, bank, whatever is close to the school. Children go there, interact with those people and come back and write essays. So normally in English, we have essay writing, but this is sometimes very abstract. But instead of making the essay writing on an abstract topic, we told them you go outside, interact with people and make an essay on that. So that becomes meaningful for the child. When the child is going to a shop and discussing with the shopkeeper about pricing of goods or inventory of the different goods, things like that, the child comes back and writes a story. That is digital storytelling. So I will share some of these links in the, you know, we have a page for discussing this whole program with you. So I'll just open that page now, because that will give you a better idea. Just give me a minute. I just share that page. Yeah, so these are some of the activities and the resources what I'm talking about, what are available here. We'll also put some of the videos that I'm talking about on digital storytelling and all on this page. Rakesh, this is the page, right? Or is the, am I getting the page wrong?
Hello.
Yeah. Rakesh, the course page link, can you share on the chat?
Sure, Guru. It is the, yeah. I'm just
here. Yeah. Anything else? Any other questions anybody has got? Otherwise, we'll go ahead into the next activity. So TCOL program. Yeah, I'll just open this link that yeah, can you all see this link, which is the link that Rakesh sir has given in the chat window? So here, some of the resources that we are talking about are available here. You can see these resources. For example, I'm talking about digital storytelling. You can see row number, item number 6. So that is an activity we did in the English, along with the English teacher in one of the schools. We have done it in many schools. We have done it in at least 9 or 10 schools. So it's an article about you can use digital storytelling in your own school. It's like a project activity where children will go interact with people outside, interact with institutions outside and come and make digital stories of them. So that is called digital storytelling. Okay, that's item number 6. If you click on the link that Rakesh sir has shared in the chat, if you go to item number 6, you will get an article which will tell you how you can do similar activities in your own school. Okay, any questions? Any questions or comments, or we can go ahead to the next activity. Yeah, anybody wants to talk, you can unmute and talk, or you can type in the chat window. Am I audible, Rakesh, Kishore? Can you hear me?
Yes, Guru.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes,
sir.
Your voice is
fine. Thank you. Everybody is quiet, so I'm wondering. Okay, anybody has any comments, questions?
Maybe they are going through the page.
Yeah. Yes, Kavita, go ahead.
Sir, hello.
Kavita, go ahead.
So under the the digital storage timeline.
Sorry, I couldn't hear you, Kavita. Can you repeat?
Sir, under the digital storytelling, there is a word timeline. What do you mean by that? Hello?
I can't see any word timeline on the screen. Akesh, can you see the word timeline? Where is the timeline? You're talking about in the document itself. You have to click on the link here. If you click on the link that is shown on the screen, you will get an article. So revise digital stories, just click on the link. If you click on the link, it will open an article which you can open and read. Can you see now? Sorry. Hello? So if you click on the link there, you will get an article.
Hello?
You can see. Yeah. Yes. Yes, Fozia. Fozia, you want to say something? So this is your course page that you can refer to. Okay, this is your audio OER course creation CLT September 2020. Okay, so I want to go ahead since nobody is talking. Now, one of the things we kept talking about is immersing the children in language, correct? We kept saying talk to the children, talk to children, talk to the children. Now, that means listening is the most important, right? So when you look at LSRW, they purposely put L in the beginning. They could have easily said WSRL, but they didn't say that. We always say LSRW because the first aspect of language learning is always listening. Listening skill in language learning, and Krashen says the same thing, that to acquire the language, the teacher has to provide a lot of input to the child. That input is language, so therefore it is audio. It is to be something the child listens to. So one of the things we are doing in the TCall program is we are helping teachers to create audio materials, and we are running a workshop for CLT participants. Anand Desai sir, you know, shared the information in the groups, and many of you have enrolled. So we are going to do 4 sessions with all of you to create audio resources, and we are going to start that process today. I'm going to give you an example of an audio resource, how it can help the process of language teaching learning. So I'm going to play a short video for us to listen to. If there are any questions before that, before I get into that, let me know. Any questions or comments? I'm getting to the next step of our class today, which is to look at why language learning first step is listening. If listening is the first step, teachers should be able to create audio material. Right now, for most of us, the resource we have is textbook. Textbook is not audio material. Textbook is reading material. And LSRW, R is third. It comes after L and S. So for a teacher who is relying on textbook, it is not going to be most useful. Teacher has to have audio books with her for the children to take to the classroom. And the children should listen to varieties of audio. And the teacher should have the skill of making the audio. So that is what we are going to do, a workshop for you, by which you can create audio materials yourselves. Okay. Shall we go ahead and listen? If there is any question, please ask. Otherwise, we'll go ahead and get into the audio material making. I'll give a generic explanation now. Those who have enrolled for the classes, we will start the first workshop from Monday. Monday, no, Rakesh? The first workshop is on Monday morning, I think. Or Monday afternoon for the primary teachers, I think. Yeah. Okay. Shall we go ahead? Nobody is talking anything. So I'm going to show a short video for you. Just listen quietly to the video. Do not talk. You can just listen.
Sat on a branch of a tribe of monkeys was growing every day. Not because there were more monkeys, but because the monkeys were growing fatter. Chakku's tribe of monkeys lived near a Shiva temple, and they were always being fed all sorts of things by people who came to visit the temple. The devotees gave them everything, from pizza to prasad, from curd rice to coconut. But the monkey's favorite food was banana. The thought of bananas drove the monkeys.
Hello, Guru.
Sorry, I had muted myself and I was talking. I stopped the video. So thank you. Thanks for alerting that I was on mute. So question to all of you. This is an audio material. So it's a story. It is told along with many elements that make it a resource. So my question to you is, I'm going to take your points and write it into a concept map. Tell me your points. What are the elements that are there in this, which made this audio resource very interesting? What are elements were there in that? Let me just share the screen again. Yeah, you can type in the chat window. You can also mute, unmute and speak. You heard this story. So what is the thing that make this story interesting for the children? So it's an audio material. It is for developing the children's ability to listen to English. You can of course tell the story, nothing wrong in that, no harm in that. But there is a lot in this which is beyond your telling the story in the classroom. So what are all the things? If you tell me, I can put it into the points here. Familiar voice, Dada Sahib, whose voice it is?
It's your voice, I think.
Whose voice? Sanjay Dutt is correct. You are able to see the screen, right? So cartoons. So cartoon, yes, is visual. I am right now focusing only on the audio aspects, not on the visual aspects, because we are talking about audio material for listening. So melodious music in the background. So can you tell me what are the other aspects? So music is there. Aspects of the music is melodious.
Banana, I want specific.
What is that? Banana, banana is what? Can you tell me what is the, how do you express that? What is it? What is what you're telling? Yeah, banana, banana is important. What is that? So there is voice modulation. I'm just noting all these points down from the chat window.
Food item, sir.
Say it again.
Repetition of the word, sir.
Yeah, so there is repetition. Repetition, yes. Also alliteration, right?
Alliteration.
Yeah, repetition, alliteration. What is?
Banana.
Sir, highlighting the words which you are speaking.
Yes,
when we are
same
speaking,
thing.
The words are highlighted.
Highlight. So don't worry about visuals. Right now, I don't want to focus on visual at all. I want to focus only on the audio. Imagine that you did not see anything. You only heard. We are talking only about the audio aspect. So there, please, when you say, can you mute your, please mute your mic if you are not talking. Vijayalakshmi, when you say background music, can you elaborate what you mean? I want very specific points. What about the background music? One aspect is melodious. Anything else? Yeah, go ahead. You can talk. Yeah, go ahead. Yes, Vadivu, go ahead.
Yes, rhythm and rhyming words also here.
Rhyming. Can you give me example of rhyming words?
I can't remember that song, sir, but I could find the rhyming words in the
pizza. Dosa dokla. Dosa
sir,
dokla.
Food item, sir. Favorite for kids, sir.
Pizza, sir. Pasta.
Pizza,
sir.
Dokla.
Dosa dokla.
Dosa, pizza.
Meaningful, right? So the words are very meaningful for the children. Bananas, payasam, dokla, pizza.
Ekadashi means ekadosa.
Ekadosa, ekadashi. So playing with words, right? So it's like a pun, correct? Not a pun. What is a dosa? Ekadosa, ekadashi.
The words are very familiar to the children.
Sir, it's just like a folk song, sir.
Yeah, song is there. So
folk dance is also there, sir.
Yeah, one second. I have to just shut down my I have to close the concept map and open again because it's hanging. Just give me a minute. I'll open it again. We'll continue.
Familiar words, sir.
Familiar words. Give me an example.
Dosa, ega, dasi.
Dosa. Yes.
That. Yeah. Dosa, sir. Then it's just like a folk dosa song, sir. Just like the folk song.
Culturally relevant words.
yes, sir, culturally relevant words, folk song, the easily they can buy out that words.
So song, right? Yes, so these sir, are all song. About song. Anything about music?
Dance as the culture, sir. Dance.
Yeah, dance is visual. I right now looking at only the audio aspects. I'm not looking at the visual aspects. Purposely I'm not looking at the visual aspects. Only the audio aspects. What are other points? Yes,
hello, sir.
Music is there, Santoshima. Santoshima, we are looking at audio only now. So give me audio points.
Sir, appropriate to the level of children.
Yeah. Also, Krishna Kumari is saying joy. So that's an emotion, right? So, emotion of joy, correct? Joy and fun, right? What else? Music with pictures. Right now, Santoshima, we are not worried about visual. We are talking only about audio. Attractive. Kavita, when you say attractive, what does it mean? Ratna, go ahead.
Sir, with the song, they can get the whole story.
Yeah, that is so song means rhyming, correct? When you say song,
the rhyming word, by hearing that song, they can get the whole story of about that monkey. We can get the whole story about the monkey.
Understanding story through song. Yeah, what else?
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes, go ahead, please share the other side. Go ahead.
How do you introduce the characters, sir, for new ways?
Character. So the both music as well as voice is character depth, right? Character descriptions.
Yes, sir.
Character descriptions through appropriate.
Familiar animal.
Familiar animal. Appropriate.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Children like monkeys, sir.
Yes, children love monkeys. So here monkey is already there.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because children are themselves like monkeys, right?
Names of the monkeys like Jigu.
All emotions. Emotions
already here.
Angry, joy.
Emotions, correct? Emotions of joy, fun, anger also. Who's angry?
Emotions like human monkeys.
Yeah, who's angry? Who's anger?
The monkey name, I forgot, sir.
Chakku, it seems, sir.
Chakku. Yeah. See alliteration. Chief Chakku.
Head of the monkey. Chief Chakku.
Chief Chakku, alliterated. So Chief Chakku is alliterated. Yeah, Chieftain. So he made him Chakrapani is his name. So instead of Chakrapani, the monkey is calling him Chief Chakku. So alliteration. What else can we say about the music? What are kinds of music is used for? Lot of focus we are given on voice. Let us focus on music now. What else is there in the music?
Sir, both the music and the voice clips are appropriate to the level of the children.
Appropriate. But tell me more about the music. What else can you tell about the music which added to the appeal? Yeah, music is also joyful. That's right. Tell me more about them. What all musical instruments you heard? Mm-hmm. What all instruments you heard?
Drums,
piano, violin, sir.
Are you able to see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Oh, fine. Classical instruments, which classical instrument? Can you tell me example?
Flute, sir. Violin, sir.
Tell me what all instruments were played. Yeah, violin was played.
Flute.
What else was played? Drums? Did you hear drums?
Keyboard, sir. Keyboard.
Mrudangam.
Yeah. What else we heard? Yes, I think Rakesh is playing violin. It. It's good.
Violin.
What else we heard?
Violin, sir.
Violin
already I mentioned. Are you all able to see the screen without a block? Rakesh, screen can't say idea.
There is a block, sir. There
is a block. No, so let me share again. Example. Yeah, let me share again. That's why I wanted to ask. system is again hanging. It's 12:47. Now, what are the instruments that did you hear? Can is my voice audible? Can you hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah, sorry, I'm not able to share the screen. So let's forget the screen. So, I'll basic idea is.
And I'll give it back.
Okay. My system is hanging, so that's why. Yeah, otherwise you can share the, you can create a concept map and share the screen also, Rakesh, you can do that, no problem. So if you want to do that, you can do that. I am not able to do it, no problem. So the idea of playing this audio to all of you was, we can actually have an activity in the classroom. Here the singing was done by the children. See, bananas, bananas, that actually children themselves sang. So we can, as English teachers, create audio resource project making in our classes where we can make audio materials, we can encourage the students to make audio materials. And will you agree with me that music made a big difference to the recitation, to the whole story? Do you agree with me that music was very, very important in the story?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Music.
Without music, yes, it will not be 30% effect. Do you agree with me? 70% effect is music.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So we are being impacted by only music. Yeah, music is very, very important. I would say without music, the voice is not, although Sanjay Das is very good, music made a very big difference to the audio resource. So what we want to do in the audio workshops, which we will start from Monday, and I think many of you have already registered us, we want to teach you how you can make similar audio materials. Of course, we may not be able to make of the same quality that you heard now. This is called Karadi Tales. The links are there in the workshop page. We may not be able to make that kind of quality because we may not get a violinist and a flutist to play for us background music. But we can use existing music available online in the internet, and we can create our own audio materials. And not only you can create audio materials and take it to your classroom and provide your children more and more opportunities to listen to language in interesting ways, not simply reading out from the textbook, but by telling them stories with music in them. We will teach you how to do this over the next 4 workshops. I think the calendar, the workshop dates are already announced to you, and we request all of you to participate and learn how to make audio materials. Once you become comfortable making audio materials, you can also get the students to do projects for making audio materials, which is the digital storytelling that I showed you some time back. Okay, it's 12:47 now. I'd like to close in another 5-10 minutes. So if there are any questions,
sir, 1 minute, sir.
Yes.
So now I would like to request our participant Abhispal to formally propose vote of thanks to our Gurumurthy Kashinath, sir. Abhispal, yes. Arudhya? Yes.
Yes, sir. Yeah, yes. Sorry, just Hitesh sir, just 2 minutes before the vote of thanks, just only 2 minutes. Okay. If there are any comments have comments from others, then we can have the vote of thanks. Any comments, okay. Any suggestions, any feedback from everybody? 2 minutes we have for sharing, and then we will close the session formally with the vote of thanks. Anybody wants to share anything? Anand Pandit, you are not spoken. Would you like to share how the session was? Did you pick up something in terms of audio material making? Anand Pandit, can you unmute and share?
Hello.
Yes, who's speaking? Hello? I'm not able to see that. Yes, go ahead.
I'm Anand.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm audible?
Yes, you're audible. Go ahead.
Actually, the session hypothesis was a very interesting and important and useful one, sir. Because all through these days, we were going through different tasks. But actually, what we have to do when our students come to school is the main task, right, sir?
Yes, absolutely.
So, today's, so all these are for our growth. So what we had today and what we got the ideas from Kashan's hypothesis for useful for the next day transaction of with my students.
Yes, and so, also
overall the main stress was on the listening skill. So after this pandemic situation and all, my first class students will be coming to the school. So they have the fresh minds. So I'll definitely start with that skill, and I'll go further for the coming years also.
Yeah, and also our next part is to teach you how to make audio material. So for your students, you can create audio materials actually, and share with them. That is the idea. You
actually,
can create audio
actually, you have taught us very well about that Crescent hypothesis, and the twist, the main twist was making these audio materials.
Yeah, that
so
is
actually true. that is the main thing, and that will be very useful for us. But the main thing is I couldn't join because I don't have the desktop or lappy, so I couldn't join. But I think my friends from the institute. So we are 89 altogether now. So I'll take the help from them.
Yeah, if you can arrange for a computer for the four classes, then you should certainly join. But without a computer, it will be very difficult to learn because what we will teach works on the computer only, not on the phone.
It's a bit difficult task at the present juncture.
I know. The pandemic makes it difficult to go out and get it.
Yeah. So few of my friends have joined already, so I'll speak from them.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
It was a very useful session, sir. Actually.
Thank you so much.
For the immediate use.
Yes, that is the whole idea of Crescent's hypothesis for helping us to implement in our classrooms right away. If there is no more comment, then formally close. Hitesh sir, any other comment? Anybody is there? Any other comment from anybody?
Yes, sir.
Yes. If there is no comment, then we'll end up the session with vote of thanks. I would like to request Abhis Pal to come turn on your camera and then propose vote of thanks. Sir, you can also come on camera.
I will do that.
Yes. Abhis Pal, you can turn on your camera and propose vote of thanks.
Yeah, my system is hanging, so I'm not able to turn the video on. The audio is working, but the video is not coming. So sorry about that.
Okay, no problem. Abhis Pal.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, audible. You can also turn on your camera so I can see you. Yeah.
I'm here, sir. So good afternoon all. I'm Avis Paul from Kerala. So it's my immense pleasure to thank Mr. Gurumurthy Kashinathan, Director, IT for Change, who gave us a highly informative and beneficial session based on Stephen Crescent's hypothesis on second language learning, organized for us as part of the 30-day CLT program by Regional Institute of English, South India, Bangalore. In this session led by Mr. Gurumurthy, sir, it was all about how interactions could be made meaningful for learners that will help in language acquisition. Stressing on Crescent's hypothesis, especially the five hypotheses, he gave us an insight on supplying comprehensible input, especially in low anxiety situations, that would contain messages that students really want to listen. In addition to that, we teachers should allow our students to produce language when our children are actually ready for it. In short, we should recognize that improvement comes from supplying communicative and comprehensible input and not from forcing and correcting language production. Dear sir, this session was really, really interesting, as a few of our participants have already mentioned, with a lot of interactions, presentations, and even the session on audio material making. And the session that you took for us was really an eye-opener for us. We could really reflect on our classroom practices done so far, and we are ready to rectify our mistakes in our classroom teaching and would definitely keep our classes stress-free and will create an ambience for children to experience language that is meaningful, in which joy and interest for learning English language will be highlighted. On behalf of all the participants and the entire RI team, I would like to thank Mr. Gurumurthy Kashinathan, sir, for your creditable session. Thank you, sir. And I would also like to thank Mr. Rakesh B, who was there to assist Mr. Gurumurthy, sir, in this entire session. Thank you, sir. And Hitesh, sir, I would like to thank you so much, being the professor and the course coordinator of this 30-day online CLT program, for coordinating such an informative session into our 30-day online course. Especially this was very, very useful for us. We are going to really try it out in our classroom, being so professional in audio making and all.
So we are eagerly waiting for that session. And as one of the objectives of this course, you are going to transform us from the present situation into leader teachers. I think that we will do justice for the plan or the focus point of your 30-day online program. Thank you so much. Thank you, RI, and thank you, Gurumurthy sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Vishwan. I, as a coordinator, I would like to once again thank Thiru Gurumurthy Kashinathan sir, Director, IT for Science, for spending 2.5 hours at this place and talking to the participants and the classes. The sessions was very useful, and I'm pretty sure that each one of our participants of 30-day CELT has been highly benefited from these sessions, and I'm pretty sure most of them would be joining this audio material creation project also, sessions also, workshop also. And I would like to thank once again, sir, for taking out your invaluable time from your schedule and engaging our participants, 30-day participants, at a stress for 2.5 hours. And I'm grateful to you. And I also like to thank Rakesh sir for assisting Gurumurthy sir and the entire sessions. Thank you very much. And thank you participants for participating and interacting in the sessions. And I appreciate your active participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hitesh sir. I'll request Rakesh sir to save the chat. Rakesh sir, please save the chat. Thanks to RISI, thanks to Dr. Hitesh, thanks to all participants for patiently participating in the course, and thanks to RISI and Hitesh sir for the opportunity. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, participants will meet on Monday at 10:20. Okay, all the best. Okay, wish you a happy weekend.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Hello, Guru.
Just save the chat.
Yeah, I did it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Rakesh. Thanks, Kishore. Thanks, everybody. Bye, everybody.
I request all the teachers to please install Audacity.
Thank you, sir.
Use it from the next week for the audio resource creation. I'll share the details in WhatsApp.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.